Hallelujah.
We have an anchor that keeps us safe as a joy.
Said the same thing, and I believe God that you also need that word. Hallelujah. You know, I gave a scenario where about people are to run a race, athletes are to run a race. Now, anytime the whistle blows, you will see that from where you sit or where you stand, they all take off at the same time. But the watch, the timekeeper, sees it different. They all don't move at the same time. There is some microseconds in between the takeoff. Now, how you begin determines how you end. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But sometimes, if an athlete gets a false start, now the whistler may try to restart the race. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So that nobody cheats, so that nobody takes advantage of the other. And then I said that is how God is. Then in the beginning of the year, you might have made your own New Year resolutions. We are in the second, in the third month.
Yes.
Sorry, we are in the third month. Perhaps you have started saying, the way the year has begun for me, it might not end well. But I came to tell you this morning that you can restart the race.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You can restart it. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And I liken it to the use of GPS. I believe we have all used GPS before. And what the GPS does is it directs us to wherever we want to go. But assuming you are to exit, at exit 34, and then you pass by 34, the GPS doesn't throw his hands in the air and say, Theo, I told you to exit at exit 34 and you didn't do it, so I don't know what to do.
Yes.
But automatically you hear a beep telling you that you have bypassed the place,
yeah.
But I am rerouting you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, what it means is that either a time will be added to your original time, or sometimes you may the time will remain. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, that is how God is.
Amen.
When you bypass the exit point, he doesn't throw his hands in the air, but he will do what? He will reroute you. And you will definitely get to your destination. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Every GPS, I've been here for the past 1 year, 6 months or so. Every GPS and every place that I've set my GPS to takes me to my destination. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So once God is in your life and he is your GPS, you will definitely get there.
Yeah.
You will definitely get to your destination. Hallelujah. So, my beloved, I want to entreat you. I want to encourage you this morning that even though you might have had a false start, that is not the end. Don't throw your hands in the air. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Just put yourself together and begin the race again. Amen. Now, today is the first Sunday in the Lent period, as Mama said, and fasting has begun. We began fasting last Wednesday, on the Ash Wednesday. Beloved, Lent is very important in the life of every Christian, such that it prepares you for the death and the resurrection of our Lord and Master Jesus Christ. So the Lent period is 40 days. Hallelujah. Technically, we will say 6 weeks. So you have to fast for 6 weeks. 40 days. So the figure 40 is very significant in the life of every Christian. Every Christian, the figure 40 is very, very significant. Why? Because it is part of the roadmap to your salvation or for your salvation. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Now, why am I saying 40 is very, very significant in your salvation journey? It was this same 40 days that Noah and his family waited for the flood. This same 40 that the same 40 days is the number of days Moses fasted on Mount Sinai as he wrote down the words of the covenant. So Moses also waited on the Lord for 40 days. 40 days is the number of years the Israelites wandered in the wilderness, tested by God in preparation for their arrival in the promised land. So when we talk about when we talk about 40 is a time of waiting, it's a time of fasting, it's a time of preparation, and it's a time of testing. Praise the Lord. So four things in 40: waiting, fasting, preparing, and what? Testing. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. All in the wilderness. And I want you to pay attention to the location. All in the wilderness. This world that we live is our wilderness. Do you believe that? So, the waiting, the fasting, the preparing, and the testing is in where? The wilderness. But when it comes to the Presbyterian Church of Ghana, we are more rigorous, in the observance of fasting during the Lent period, believing that regular fasting is crucially important discipline for one's spiritual growth. So we believe as Presbyterians that if you want to grow spiritually, then fasting must be part of your life. Not just going hungry, but fasting and praying. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So in this period, in the Lent period, I want to just start briefly on the Lent and then we'll go to today's sermon. In this period, meat, dairy products, and eggs are avoided. Yes, now that was the reason for that. You know, in the biblical days, in those days, in those days, these dairies, these eggs and meat are considered luxury foods. They are considered luxury foods. I remember when I was in primary, in that village, there was a man who rented, we were in a compound house. And every night, as I sit and read my books, I'll be like, when can I also do this? Because at that time it was largely,
you know, to be eating eggs and meat, and even today,
go to Ghana, they eat chicken only in Christmas.
Yes.
I mean, why?
Yeah.
It's happening. So it's largely. So in Lent period, we are saying that get out of that largely life. Much as here, get out of that luxury life and depend on only bread. Those days in the biblical times, bread was something for the poor, and that is why Jesus Christ used bread, you know, as scenarios in his parables. And then when it comes to food, that is what I have mentioned, you only depend on fish. So bread and fish, because I need the young for, you know, Ebian. But technically, Lent is giving up your pleasures, things that gives you pleasure. It's here, Yawarin. I hope you believe, you understand.
Yes.
One worry, you abstain from sex for the 40 days if you are fasting. And they are very difficult. You know. So you give up something pleasurable. Not only sex, but things that you are near amount. And the things that you do up. Amount when you do what? You give up on them for that period. Even Presbyterians, as a typical Presbyterian, will never schedule his or her wedding period in the Lent period. No, we don't. Ghana, they were up over here waiting during the Lent period. I am blessed. Because when my head, near my hands, I say, Yedi. And even in the Lent period, we don't put on white. Things are signify victory. So we wear ash. Ash is very common. Color, I don't friends, anyone.
Gray.
I did the BS. Me say, open the boot. No, you know, open the boot. I know you mean drunk. Roman. So usually in these times we put on gray. We put on gray colors and dark colors, signifying say we are in the morning period and we are gearing up for something, our salvation. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. It's the Lent, you know. But today is truthfulness in worship. Truthfulness in worship. Shall we have a word of prayer? Father, we have gathered before you one more time to listen to your teachings. Indeed, you are master teacher. Come and teach us. Your children, we have come with teachable hearts. We are ready to learn from you. We are ready to walk what you teach us. Help us to understand you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So, truthfulness in worship. But I want to ask a very simple but difficult, a very simple question. But the answers are quite difficult. When was the last time you got tempted? When was the last time in your life that you got tempted? Really, sincerely and deeply tempted to sin. When was the last time? Were you deeply tempted to sin? I mean, Jesus, as I ask the questions, you'll be thinking about them. To do something or say something, you know very well that you are not supposed to say or do. When was the last time?
This morning.
Too much, man. Hallelujah. What was it? Was it a new type of temptation, or it was something habitual? Something that you do every time, might want to get out of it. What kind of temptation was that? How many times did you resist that temptation and walked in victory? I believe you are taking inventory of those things. Were you defeated? Did you succumb to the temptation? What were the results? As a young preacher coming, who at that time thought that fasting was everything, and then I will fast for 14 days, and I will tell God, you know, in those days I grew, I was telling the children's service teachers when I was having orientation with them the other day, that children's service is better to you than your mother, Papa. Why? Because we were taught, you know, David, come Goliath. And then at the brain. We were not taught life issues. Relating the David and Goliath issue to our lives. We were not taught. And now David, come Goliath, ain't he? So I grew from secondary school before I got to know even what fornication was or meant. Because, as I said, yes, I'm here, I'm here. Hallelujah. So as a young preacher coming, you fast for 14 days and in the fasting you pray to God and say, God, I am sin again. I have a girlfriend. Today is the end of the relationship. God, and you fast and fast. And then on the 14th day, when you are breaking the fast, only to hear Coco. Who is there? Send me. You. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is a typical temptation.
Yes,
sir. How truthful was I in those temptations? Truthfulness. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, in the third reading, Jesus had just been baptized, anointed by the Holy Spirit for his messianic ministry and acknowledged by his father. You know, in his baptism, the father called him, "This is my beloved son. I am very pleased with you." That was the accolade that God gave to his son. But Jesus Christ didn't enjoy that accolade. He didn't enjoy, say, if I said, "Oh, you're on Hiniba." Hey, I'm not here, President Kufuado Ba. That kind of thing. Jesus never enjoyed that. He accepted that responsibility, and just after his baptism, Bible said he was led into the wilderness. Now listen to this. That was the Luke's account. Luke said he was led, but Mark, who was with him, said he was driven out. It was a compulsion. Because there is a roadmap, and you're going into the wilderness will fulfill the salvation, reconciling man to God. Hallelujah. So that was Mark for you. Mark will say it as it is. Praise the Lord. So he said that Jesus was driven into the wilderness. But I asked myself, why the wilderness? Why the wilderness? Number one, the wilderness because Jesus wasn't yet ready to enter into his public ministry. At that time, he was in the preparatory stage. And so he needed a place, a desolate place, a place that no one can talk to him, a place that nothing can distract him. Empty, what me and Kotna can think, send me here fasting. No way! I always tell, I gave a business talk in Azizawa, and I was telling them, who per toffee, who did, when he did, talk to one, who could did that, and could did loan, and could, and don't toffee. We go over Boca. Praise the Lord. Over Boca. Amen. So Jesus, at that point, because he was preparing, needed to be in the desert to avoid all distractions, and to also make sure to set obedient that connection that you'll be able to commune with his father. Hallelujah. Amen. Because that is why anytime he was with his disciples and he want to pray, Bible said, and he will isolate himself, he will leave the disciples and go somewhere, because on person will be between Kulonde and praise the Lord. Number two, the desert, of course, because the particular place where Jesus was taken to was the home of John the Baptist. It was on his land. Maybe at John the Baptist, and it was the same place where Moses and Elijah also had their fasting and encountered the Lord. And it will be a consul order. And that is why for some of us, we believe in Atria Mountains, we believe in Seko, we believe in places that people gather on mountains to do what? To pray. Because a beer they have had their encounter with the Lord. Exodus 24:18, 34:28. So fasting has a way of lifting and preparing you to connect your heart to God. Fasting allows one to focus on the spiritual realm more intently. And Jesus, in the wilderness, he was focused. When he goes on his knees and lifts his hands and prays to God and calls his father, the father appeared to him. And also try as much as possible even to change the metabolism of the system. When you fast, certain things change in the system.
Doctor, hallelujah.
So this is the reason why God took his son, his beloved son, into the wilderness. But remember this, Jesus was not alone. Remember he said, and the spirit, he was full of the spirit. And now, praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Even though physically he was alone, spiritually, he had a guide. He had somebody who was encouraging him, who was teaching him a lot of things. But second question I asked was, the first one was, why the temptation? The second one was, why the temptation? But remember in James chapter 1, verse 13, the word of God said, God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. You remember that quotation? Mm-hmm. James 1:13. So why the temptation? Why the temptation? But remember at that particular time, Jesus was full human and full spirit. It is happening. He had come into the human life form. And so he can be tempted. You remember Genesis chapter 22, I believe. Genesis chapter 22 about Gethsemane. Yes, the Garden of Gethsemane. Something also went on there. But you see, in his temptation by the devil, Jesus had two weapons. The first weapon was the Holy Spirit, and the second weapon was the Word of God. And surprisingly, we all seated here this afternoon, we all have the same weapons. But why is it that we need the NDA? Hallelujah. We'll get there. You see, sometimes, being tempted makes you feel dirty. But I want to clear this to this afternoon. In pretty afternoon, it's 19. Like I said this morning, and I said tonight. Temptation is not sin. Let's get that clear. Being tempted doesn't mean that you have done what?
You have sinned.
Satan may tempt us or tempt you by putting evil thoughts in your mind, but we can push them right out again with God's help. Oh, it is about 3 months. Why? Why, Bonnie? Hallelujah. But on this afternoon, he has given you that power, that authority. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 7. It said he didn't give us the spirit of fear, but he gave us power, authority, and self-discipline. Praise the Lord. So, Martin Luther once said, he said, you can't help it if a bird flies over your head, but you don't need to let him make a nest in your head. And the temptation is there. Who pray on pole, whether you like it or not, it will definitely do what? Come. But you do not have to allow it to do what? To let you sin. Praise the Lord. Amen. Now, are temptations necessary at all? Are they necessary? And why should Jesus be tempted at all? You see, innocent faith is not a strong faith. When Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, they were sinless. There was nothing to tell them there. Said, so temptation is very, very necessary and very, very important in our lives. Innocent faith may be pure, but it needs testing to be strong. Your faith, you need testing of your faith to be what? To be strong in the Lord. I once said a story I read in, from a book. One of these Ghanaian writers, and he was talking about, I think I've forgotten the title of the book, where a man one day walked into his office and he was handed a sack letter. Now, when he got home, he saw two of his kids coming home, and the problem was they'd been sacked from school. Now, as he was telling the kids, let's go, I want to go to speak to the headmaster, then the landlord also came. It's like, for the past 4 months, you have not paid your rent, and I need the money. So he was like, landlord, this is my sack letter. And then his phone rang and was like, the wife is in the hospital. And all the man said, Lord, I thank you for taking me through this. I know you are testing my faith, and I know I will go back.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
How many of us can do that? I can meet you. I will and will and will and will. But then everybody knows it. Hallelujah. So you need temptation and testings to be strong, to remain in the faith. You must be tested. One test, I may see one three exams. If you don't write exams, you will never know whether you know the stuff or not. Hallelujah. So many disciples have discovered that while their lives were pretty controlled by Satan before their conversion, after their conversion, a battle begins. And there is that inner war. Oh, when you're going some day, everything seems pretty nice for you. Nobody cares about you. But the moment you say, Lord, I accept you, I believe you, I confess today that you are my Lord, then trouble begins. Then you ask yourself, when I was in the world, I had everything free. Now I come to Christ and trouble. Oh, when you are coping, they are all part to shape you, to prepare you for the kingdom.
Amen.
But I want to say that temptations, you see, sometimes they say, as human beings, temptation, the other day, I was preaching someone and I told them, I'm married. And yes, I don't see. When I see beautiful ladies, I see them. But I have a covenant with my wife. I have a covenant with God. So what you say? Good. Hallelujah. And one in I is temptation.
Hallelujah.
Anyway, get is the proverbial job, he said. Get is the proverbial job, he said. When I come, when I go to book, no, that's how I preach. At last, when I must go to make it more fun. So that we can move forward. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So Jesus was taken to the wilderness. And the first thing, he was tempted on three things. The first one, you see, the devil is very kind. He saw that this man has fasted for 40 days. Oh, come, Adam. Oh, come, Adam. Hallelujah. Oh, come, Adam. So the first temptation was very simple for him to do because I commanded him for how many days?
40 days.
So it was very easy. If now listen, but see, if you are the son of man, condition. So what the enemy sought to do is say, you are not the son of man. But if you believe so, then turn these stones around you. Turn them into loaves of bread and do what?
Eat.
And eat. Ah. I'll show my powers. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Jesus. When I came, I was looking for IHOP on Waze, and he directed me about 0.3 miles.
Mm-hmm.
That's about, yeah, there's some trainings or something. There. Let's take this place to be the wilderness. Jesus would have equally gone there to get something to do or to break his back. But you see the temptation. Turning stones into loaves of bread was very, it was the quickest. You need not to travel anywhere. It was what? The quickest. And of Samson himself, he knew very well that Christ can do what? Can do it. What is the lesson here? What is the lesson here? Even though you have the power, a woman said, but you don't exercise it when it is not needed. That is the first lesson. The second one was that Jesus was tempted on the flesh. Hallelujah. Let me say here that things of this world, if you grab them legitimately, you are good to go. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So Jesus was tempted to meet a legitimate physical need by illegitimate means. No, come then. So it was legitimate. So then, what did he do? But when you it was hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Good. Then as I said, if you are the son of God, so Satan was saying that you are not the son of God. And you know what? He said, and that is what I said. Me, I will show my powers. I will show my powers to the whole world that indeed I am the Christ. Number two, Jesus was tempted on power and wealth. Power and wealth. The second temptation is to authority and worldly glory. The devil leads Jesus up to a high place and shows him the kingdom of the world in a moment of time. So Satan claims both ownership. So if you carefully listened to the reading, Satan was claiming ownership of the world. Say, media. Forgetting that the one you want, what you want to give to Jesus, already he owns it. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So Satan claims both ownership of and the powers, the power to bestow political powers and material wealth and splendor. So we understand that we live in the present. We must. I made some mistakes here, but let's continue. We would rather get our rewards now and worry later about the future. And what is the essence of it? If Jesus had grabbed that, it could have been chaos. If you grant coming into the salvation, that would have been car. It would have ended there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Good. And the one here said, from time to time, we will walk in the roadmap of God. So Jesus knew that power was important to his mission as a Messiah. But it must be power bestowed by his Father and not to be our head in. What in change? Sami petunia and Sami Eden. Miko Eden Yanko Pong. I said, Miko Eden Yanko Pong. And then the last one was the temptation of popularity. The temptation of popularity. Let me ask this question. Have you ever had dreams of being a famous person? Have you ever had dreams of being a movie star, a superstar? I think I have had one several, I have had it several times as a young guy coming. I mean, just saying, sometimes we have that desire to enter into a respected profession. You want to be popular in school. You want to be known, you know, everywhere. We've had those dreams and aspirations. But you do, honey. Now, to me, or for me, I think that the third temptation was to try and push Jesus. At that time, like I said, the Hall of Fame, into a Hall of Fame. The Guinness Book of Records. Say, on the white afro, now when good about it, I'm a buffer man behind you then, and you know, Guinness Book of Records. The temptation of fame. There is a thing like one week here, you brag about nothing. Sometimes when I am traveling and there is this traffic jam all these things, you know, come to play. But at a human level, we see manipulations, you know, constantly. We can't get our spouses to do certain things or something that we want. Or take an action that leaves him or no other choice. Force your husband or your wife to bail you out, since the alternative is imaginable. It will happen to be, and you can trying to be, not the bail because if you are no corner here. And I listened to a preacher on radio, on Facebook, and he was saying that he was on board from Kumasi to Accra, and then he was preaching, and then somebody had a call, and the person said, "Oh, my doing someone." Meanwhile, they were still at the Kumasi bus station. And then he went and sat behind, by the person, and said, "Kwajo, Ejinasuo, Kumasi station, Afena, Ebetuo." And then he had the person from the other side say, "Ah, then you've been on some Kumasi station, now you see where things are." You see what life, you know. Sometimes we force people to say nice things about us because we want to be popular. Sometimes we force people to let us to see us as the philanthropist, whatever title that you want to, you know, put on yourself. We force people. Hallelujah. But we have forgotten that your way, what you do, is what describes you. The big question this morning is truthfulness in worship. When all these temptations come your way, can you stand? Jesus overcame the temptation with two things: the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. We have those two things available for us today. Make use of them.
Amen.
And when He comes the second time, you will see. Well done. Coffee. Come and join me at where my father is. God bless you and keep you.
Amen.
Shall we have a word of prayer?
What is that one thing? What is that one temptation that you always lose the battle on? What is that thing? Talk to God about it. Talk to him about it. What is it? That particular thing. There is one thing in your life that pushes you into the hands of the enemy. What is that thing? Talk to God about it. Talk to God about it. What is it? Lift up the Lord, the Lord, from me, from my head. If say, Mark, me come ebu. Me come ebu. Lord, have mercy. Deliver me, oh Lord. Deliver me from this sin. Talk to God. In 30 seconds, continue talk to God about it. Catching him, catch him. It's an erupti. Mabao, unchain a mabba. Yisa this way. Sanko nuyami, erupti bubu fi mabrabu. Namin to me, what sent them is saying, so you need to be back. The temptations will definitely come. I need that strength, the Holy Spirit. And your word to overcome. I need it, O Lord. I need it, O Lord. Oh Jesus. Oh Jesus.
I'm coming home.
Your arms are widely open to embrace us into the kingdom. Everybody, say, yeah, I want to about change. Now, we need thy Holy Spirit to always flee from sin. Because we know that we are accountable to every action. And you take in this life. And I didn't bring your mother. CCA. Everybody CCA. And San Waba.
Yen fee. And we are see your harmony of money. At the tea and soya. And the bonny moon papa.
You who knew him saying it to you. Thank you for an answered prayer. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died in Mary, descended into hell, and on the third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From whence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.